Well, good morning. Today, Dr. Virginia Caine and I will announce some updates to our COVID-19 response. But first, let me deliver a message to residents who still fail to recognize this moment for the crisis that it is. Indianapolis has faced this virus since the beginning of March. The time for warnings is over. This weekend, several businesses flouted the guidance that is in place to stop COVID from spreading. They did this even as children, teachers, and administrators cautiously are returning to school. As other businesses remain closed at great cost. As families make painful sacrifices because they want to do their part to bring an end to this pandemic. The sight of spectators at a venue packing the stands without masks is beyond discouraging. We have spent months clawing our way to where we are. To see others possibly squander that in the course of just one afternoon is painful. Some who broke these provisions have acknowledged the gravity of their mistakes and they have paid fines. Others remain under the sway of irresponsible voices, spreading lies that this crisis is invented or imagined. Their selfishness is an insult to the families of the 3,000 Hoosiers who have lost their lives while infected with this virus. Whether they were old or young, they died from a disease that did not exist this time last year. I have spent too much time with healthcare professionals who are demoralized because of this irresponsible behavior. I have talked to and read about too many families with members of all ages who will endure lifelong hardships because of this disease. Despite all of that, I am not cynical. As I mentioned last night during my State of the City address, every day we are seeing examples of Indianapolis coming together as one city to tackle this challenge head on. First responders serving the public at a time when everyone else is being told to stay home. Educators working 80-hour weeks in classrooms and virtually to ensure that our students are not left behind. Doctors and nurses delivering life-saving health care despite the risk to their own health. Food and service providers serving thousands of meals to those who are in need across our city, while volunteers lend a hand, ensuring that no family is left hungry during this time. Neighbors checking on neighbors, small businesses retooling to make masks or sanitizer, philanthropic and corporate leaders stepping forward, and above all, residents masking up for one another. This virus is a long-term test of our unity, a test that we can and that we will pass. That's why, once again this morning, I'm pleading with all residents and business owners. Do your part to follow the public health guidance. Avoid unnecessary risk for you and your family, and above all, listen to responsible and informed voices. I'd like to introduce one of those voices right now, Dr. Virginia Caine, the director of the Marion County Public Health Department. Dr. Caine.
Thank you, Mayor Hogsett. I'd like to start by acknowledging the sacrifices been made by many of our residents. It is because of your commitment to social distancing of 6 feet, to staying home when you were sick, and to participating in contact tracing efforts, and more importantly, to wearing your mask, that we are seeing our positivity rate trend downward. But while some of the data discussed today shows signs of progress, we must all recommit to these tasks. For as we saw in weeks previously, if we relax, these trends can change quickly. That's why I have directed the Marion County Public Health Department to begin stepping up enforcement of the critical mask mandate and social distancing restrictions that we have put in place. And we will continue to closely monitor data to ensure that our actions are keeping our children safe as they return to school, and our entire city safe as we continue to strive for a new normal. And now I'm going to walk you through what we are seeing in Marion County. They got to stop that. So when we look at the percent of newly tested people testing positive for COVID-19, this is one of the major criteria that we are using, our positivity rate. You will see how back in late June, we had a positivity rate of about 5% positivity rate. And then we started to slowly climb in terms of our number of people being positive for COVID-19. Now, some of it was related to, we did a phenomenal job of increasing our testing, but it also indicated that we were starting to see an increase in community spread with these numbers. And so recently, all the way through August the 3rd, we had a 7-day positivity rate of 9.2%. But you can also see that it looks like we're going in the direction of a decline going for the next week from August the 6th through August the 11th, although this data is preliminary. But we feel that we're going and starting to go in the right direction. So when we look at our newly confirmed cases, and as you can see the increase in our cases, you will see that we have slowed our increased number of cases. So whereas back in July to the 20th, we had increased over 14 cases per day, in our last week from July the 27th to the 3rd, we have now reduced the number of new cases by about 7 cases per day. So we're slowing down in our newly confirmed cases, ending at a case rate of 155 cases per day over 7-day average. And one of the reasons that has been beneficial to us and very critical for us is our ability to make sure we're providing sufficient testing in our community, and we need and have to meet the goal of at least testing over 1,500 individuals in our community. And based on this slide, you will see that we've made substantial gains. And as a result, We are nearly almost increasing our laboratory tests to about 2,500 a day. So substantial increase in getting the laboratory test available out there for our Marion County residents. When we look at one of our other critical factors that we look to see if we're monitoring spread in our community, I'm happy to say that when we look at the emergency room visits for patients who actually are exhibiting COVID-19 symptoms from July the 8th through August the 7th, you will see that we've started to see a decline now in our ED visits with COVID-19 symptoms. And so as you can see, we are a little bit under about 18 visits from an emergency room visit standpoint. If we look at our hospital admissions, we saw a little slight increase in our hospital admissions for COVID-19 starting around about the first week in July the 27th. But in the last week, we are starting to see a decline in our hospital admissions where we are just averaging maybe about 18 patients per day of COVID-19 symptoms. Next slide. And as we look at our deaths compared to when we were at our peak, where we're averaging over 12 deaths per day, we're now significantly down to about one death per day. So we are plateauing related to our deaths, but substantially have decreased since the peak of our epidemic related to our deaths. Next slide. So to be able to take a look at this at a glance based on my table, that you can see that from the first week in July, last week in July, from July the 24th through the 31st, we started out with 134 cases. And then from July the 24th to July the 31st, where we have 148 cases, that was a 14 case increase in that last week of July. But if you go from July the 31st, with the number of cases we were averaging per day at a 7-day average of 148 cases down to August the 6th, we have only seen a 7-day increase. So we are definitely slowing down our increase in new cases, and we are looking like it may be starting to trend toward plateauing or being flat for our new increasing cases. Very similar that we see with our emergency room visits, that they have declined in this past week. The similar with our hospital admissions, that they are on the decline this past week since July the 31st, and the number of deaths have remained flat and stable. Next slide. So one of the interesting factors that we have looked at the demographics about who is or where these cases are occurring by race and ethnicity. And when we look at this, we see a higher proportion in our people of color, that from March the 6th through August the 9th, the largest case rate of cases with COVID-19 are in our Hispanic Latino X population, where 2,240 Hispanic individuals make up these cases per 100,000 population, followed by the second largest group are our Blacks or African Americans, who make up 1,380 of these cases rate per 100,000 population, then followed by our Asian Pacific Islanders case rate of 1,000 cases, with the lowest case rate seen in our white population at 772 cases. Thank you. Next slide. So when we break it down by gender, you can see that the highest number of cases appear to be in the Hispanic females and males with the highest rates. But the females, it appears, are more likely to be diagnosed with COVID-19 than the males of the same race. So you will see similar numbers, high numbers in our Hispanic females, followed by a high case rate of our African-American females, except when you get to the Asian Pacific Islander groups, where we now see that the men are more likely to be diagnosed than females, but then reverts again back to in our white population, where females seem to have a little slight edge with higher rates than their male counterparts. So one major factor, and I know as schools are reopening, I thought it would be important for me to reemphasize what our school district action points were for reopening schools. And we break them down by a color stage and level. And so that based on the positivity rate in our communities, if we had a positivity rate between 0 to 5, that's the green level. That's the go signal that we can open all schools, elementary schools, as well as middle and high schools, where all students can go and attend in person. But if we're at our yellow level, and I want to remind you, we're at a 9.2% positivity, but we feel we're going in the right direction where we think it is lowering, that all elementary school students can return to school in person. But if you're a middle or high school, we recommend that you have a hybrid combination of in-person and online preparation in your schools, unless waivers may be granted to you for certain circumstances. And if we hit the orange level, that's if we get a positivity rate of 11% to 12%, that means all children in elementary school can still attend in person, but we will not be able to allow any middle or high school students to attend school in person. They must all undergo virtual or online training. And then our red level, that means that we can no longer have any in-person instruction for students, whether you're elementary, middle school, or high school, at a positivity rate of 13 or higher. So again, I will address when we look at Marion County and we look at it based on our confirmed cases so far, and we look at what we call our positivity rate, so that in the 0 to 4 years of age, the positivity rate is about 0.2 some percent. When we look at our age group from 5 to 10 years of age, that positivity rate is about 3.4 to 7%, 0.37%. But once we jump up to our sixth graders or higher, from the 11 to the 13 years of age, we now see a greater positivity rate of almost 0.5%. And then we reach our age group of 14 to 17 years of age, we see a positivity rate of about 1.2%. Who are positivities in terms of that percentage of students 14 to 17 are testing positive in Marion County. And finally, once you reach the age of 18 to 24, nearly 2.4% of that age group are positive for COVID-19. So next slide. And so we've seen a change in our demographics since the start of this epidemic in March, where when we looked at that group, nearly 40% of our cases were over the age of 60, and only 1% was in the age group 0 to 19 years of age. But fast forward now to the month of July, where we've seen that the percentage of cases in the 0 to 19 years of age have gradually increased to about 12%. And we see now that the age group that we're manifesting with the greatest number of cases of 50%, half of our cases are in the age group between 20 to 39 years of age, with the predominant number of those cases between the age group of 20 to 29 years of age, with the next group followed by our at nearly 25% of our 40 to 59 years of age. So we're seeing a much greater younger population, primarily starting at the age of 20 through 59 years of age, making the bulk of our cases. Next slide. So in terms of directing our attention to our public health order, that's based on what has occurred since our last public order, we spent the last 2 months really based on education and warnings in regard to our enforcement of our public health order. We have 407 complaints about violations of the order. We issued 2 citations, but this past weekend, as Mayor Hogsett mentioned, we saw high-profile potential violations that occurred. And the Marion County Public Health Department issued a $1,000 fine. And we will now immediately start issuing $1,000 fines for businesses and venues in violation. Let me repeat this. We take this seriously, okay? And we know that we've got to step up our enforcement. So I will repeat, we will now start to immediately issue 1,000 fines for business and venues in violation. The education and the warning period is over. So you can report violations to us by calling 300-317-221-5500 during business hours, or emailing our health department at marionhealth.org. marionhealth.org. Now, let me also just say this. You know, people will report a violation and they think that something's going to happen immediately. It requires an investigation by us, okay? Depending on the time, sometimes an event may occur. So don't always have the expectation, based on when we receive the complaint, and a lot of times the event has already happened, that you may not see a violation within 24 hours, depending on us doing a thorough investigation. Next slide. So our public health order update is that our bars and our nightclubs will remain closed. And this includes any 21 and over places that did not have a full menu before March the 1st, 2020. So if you have any venue that has an age restriction of that you must be 21 and over in these facilities and that you did not have a full menu before March the 1st, 2020, your bar nightclubs will remain closed. And this will be effective Friday, August the 14th at 12 a.m. Effective Friday, August the 14th at 12 a.m. Outdoor dining remains at 50% capacity. Our indoor dining at all ages in restaurants will be at a 50% capacity. Full menu, age-restricted restaurants, though, will only be able and allowed to have a 25% capacity indoors. So full menu, age-restricted restaurants will only be able to have, serve constituents at a 25% capacity if they are indoors. Now, table service is required for all indoor dining and no bar service is permitted. And masks are required inside those facilities when not eating and drinking. Now, this has received a lot of attention across the country, and we have done an extensive evaluation related to this. We have met with some different experts. We have spent an enormous amount of time and effort with our Indiana High School Athletic Association, and we have reviewed extensively the guidelines and the personal protective restrictions and things in place from our school sports events, and that we are now stating that school sports can occur, but they are will be required to follow the Indiana High School Athletic Association guidelines. Not just recommendations, they're going to be required to follow it. And for example, football, social distancing of 6 feet at all times while they're in the team box, no handshakes at the coin toss, masks must be worn on the sidelines, but you can look at the Indiana High School Athletic Association guidelines for more information. We are restricting the spectators in the stands, so no more than 250 people will be allowed to be in the stands total. Let me repeat that. No more than 250 people will be allowed in the stands, and they must maintain 6 feet social distancing unless you're within the same and reside in the same household. And this does differ from the governor's order regarding the sections in the stands. And masks will be required for all individuals in the stands, and there'll be no congregation at the concession facilities. And so, Mayor, I'll stop there, but these were the highlights related to our public health order.
Great. At this time, we'll begin our Q&A. As always, if you'll put your name and outlet in the box, we will call on you. First up, we have Steve Jefferson from WTHR. Hi, Steve.
Hey, I think I was trying to unmute and you was trying to unmute me too. Made me mute me. Good morning, everybody. Dr. Caine, I would like to ask, you talked about stepping up enforcement. What changes now as opposed to before when you talk about stepping up enforcement, please, by the health department?
So I think that there's two things. We're looking to increase the number of people that we're going to be putting out into the community in terms of doing enforcement. So that's one. Increasing our number of personnel out there just devoted to this, looking at the enforcement of our rules. But the second has to do with, you know, we started out with a warning, and then the next fine that we were doing were $50 fines, but it didn't seem to have an impact. So no warnings this time, no $50 fines. We immediately go to a $1,000 fine. We need to get your attention. And we go higher than that, than the $1,000 fine.
Eric Berman, WIBC.
Hi, can you hear me and not the feedback? Excellent. My question is in part about the weekend. Both the mayor and Dr. Caine referenced multiple incidents. I think we all know about the speedrome. How many other incidents are we talking about over the weekend?
Maybe a potential of about two more events that occurred that had some concern for us.
Great. Tom Healy from Indy Midtown Magazine.
Hi, thank you, Dr. Caine. I'm not trying to be glib. I am just curious, though, if you would define full menu, because there are places that serve alcoholic beverages and deep fried cheese balls or pizzas from the microwave. Could you sort of outline what you mean by a full menu?
So if you won't mind, I'm going to let my colleague, Mr. Paul Babcock, answer that question. I think he eats out a little bit more than I do. And so, Mr. Babcock, would you mind?
Always a pleasure to be able to answer questions and help you out here in these situations. So when we're talking about a full menu, we're talking about having a kitchen, where individuals work, places where, you know, there's an actual cook and time going on versus somebody throwing cheese balls in a microwave to help someone soak up alcohol. So that's really what we're looking at. Obviously, the issue here is, you know, we're in this for the long haul. And so we are working with our partners to try and make sure we define businesses, restaurants, things that potentially spread COVID-19 or are vectors for the spread of COVID-19 in the most accurate way possible. And to some extent, this is uncharted territory. And so I'm glad I'm able to help my colleague, Dr. Caine, answer some of these questions. As someone who, you know, eats out a lot, I really am able to help as much as possible.
Oh, goodness. Erica Heron, Indy Star.
Hey, can you just clarify, Dr. Caine, your school district action points? You know, what would a rate of something like 5.5 or 10.5 that fall in between, what would this qualify as?
So technically the 10.5 would follow in the yellow level. The 10.5 actually going up to 10.9. It was just easier in terms of simplifying it by the 5-point intervals. But the 10.5 would, anything up to 10.9 would be a yellow level.
Russ Dodge, WITT.
Hi, good morning. I have two questions. First off, is there a greater fine for repeat violators or something that's more egregious? And I'll use the speedrome as an example where, you know, by not sticking with the 25%, they sold thousands of extra tickets. $1,000 fine is minuscule by comparison to maybe the tens of thousands of extra dollars they made. And the second thing deals with the high school sports. Why would you not use percentages for how many people could be in the stands, where you have some high schools that have room for 1,000 people and some schools have stands that could accommodate 5,000 people or more?
So let me just take the first question. Yes, if we felt we had something more egregious in terms of violation of our order in terms of social distancing and not wearing masks, it generates a much larger fine. And if we thought someone was a repeat violator related to that fine, that would also increase our fine significantly in terms of trying to send a message. So that's the response to the first question. I think for the second question, in terms of the capacity of some of the stands, part of the problem is that when you get a very large group of individuals together, our concern is that we might see a substantial number of people congregating together related to these sports, even though you have even though you have You might have two opposing teams and they want to bring their own spectators. I think we want to get a little more experience with the number of spectators at this level of 250 to make sure that we're not having community spread. And until we get a feel for that, we want to really keep the numbers at 250 related to that. But also, one last thing I forgot to mention in my first response, know that if we have a major repeat violator that's egregious, don't forget we can shut that business down as well. So I want to make that clear.
Ross McQuain, Fox 59.
Good morning, Dr. Caine. In Paul's defense, I would like to point out that pork rinds and beer nuts are not necessarily one of the major food groups. So I just want to speak up for Paul on behalf of that. Yourself, Dr. Caine, in order to keep an eye on our children as they go to school, do you see perhaps any more emphasis on testing on a mass level, similar to what we did in the spring when it looked like we had to send a lot of investigators into nursing homes to do the testing there, because that's where it looked like the outbreak was, in order at schools, if you test early and you test quick, you were able to get on top of it real quick.
So that's Rush, you highlight a really important point, and I think this is a critical point for us in terms of response. We have response teams, nurses prepared and ready that if we're required, that we have a positive case and we need to get in there and provide testing. The critical point is to get in there within 24 hours and provide the testing for the folks who may be exposed. So I think that's really critical. So we have a team of nurses prepared to do that for schools that identify. If they don't have those resources, we can make it available for them, and we plan on making it available for them. And where we can provide free testing, and right now, our turnaround time for testing is about 48 to 72 hours. We're working on trying to obtain some machines and testing where we can have a 24-hour turnaround. But currently, right now, we're looking at 48, and it could be 72 hours if we're hitting a Friday after 12 o'clock noon.
Sherry from the Indy Star.
Hello. Hi. Thank you for taking my question. Basically, this is a related question, somewhat on testing. Dr. Caine, what would you advise that people get tested? I mean, obviously, people who are symptomatic should be tested, but the positivity rate is also dependent in part on the denominator of how many people are getting tested. So what is your advice, first of all, about who should be getting tested, when, and then also if you could share any insight you're getting from contact tracing about how the coronavirus cases that we're seeing these days, where people are getting exposed, how they're getting affected. Obviously, it's probably too soon to see anything from this weekend, if anything were to come of that.
So, I think you asked me about three or four questions. So let me have you ask me your first question, and I'll go individually. So repeating that, your first question.
My first question is, when should people be tested beyond being symptomatic? Because obviously the positivity rate is dependent on the denominator, if only symptoms to a certain extent.
Okay, so I think one of the things we need to look at is, let's say, for example, we have some really high-risk individuals out there. So you may have a patient that's a cancer patient that's undergoing chemotherapy, or someone is undergoing a transplant. And so anybody in that household who may not have any symptoms, but I've got an individual that it's extremely high risk if they could contract the coronavirus, it might behoove them to get themselves tested to make sure that they are coronavirus negative. I think anyone that feels that they might have been exposed to a colleague or something that may have had symptoms, and that colleague may say, well, I think I've just got allergies. I'm coughing and I'm sneezing and my nose may be running or whatever. And so, when you have a little heightened awareness, I might recommend that you get tested in that situation.
Sam Quinn from the IBJ.
Yeah, my question is about, should we know how many bars and nightclubs would fall into this category that need to be closed, and how do businesses determine whether or not they meet that criteria? And then also, why $1,000? Is that the fine someone mentioned for some businesses? That's probably a drop in the bucket in terms of they might make more that weekend than what they're paying in a fine. So how do we sort of keep businesses from opening with just a $1,000 fine?
So, Paul, because it's related to the bar, that might be one that you may want to answer.
I can handle that, Dr. Caine. Thanks again for punning about food and beverages. So in regards to figuring out which restaurants are going to be impacted, the health department has a food program. And so, they worked with us to help craft this language. And so there's a lot of licensure issues. So restaurants, establishments will have a licensure from the health department that'll determine where they are classification wise. And then, from there, you can determine who fits the definition. Off the top of my head, I don't think I could give you the number that's impacted. I'm sure Dr. Caine and I could figure that out over the course of the next couple of days. So that would be really the answer for that one. And then I'll punt back to you, Dr. Caine, for the second point.
We find up to $1,500 a day in terms of an establishment that we think that they're not compliant. And so that's the maximum that we can do, a fine of $1,500 a day. But we can make the determination of how many days and the length of that that we can find an individual. So it can get to become very expensive, but I think even more important than that, if we see maybe, for example, two very egregious incidents that occur, then we can shut that business down indefinitely. So that's a risk, a very risk, that if we're concerned that they're flouting our recommendations for the safety of this community, we will close their business.
Elizabeth from the Indy Star.
Hi, can you hear me? Okay. I have a couple of questions. On ramping up enforcement, does the immediate $1,000 fine, does that apply to individuals as well violating the mask order? And then how many personnel are in the field now enforcing these orders?
So I don't know I don't know the exact number of individuals I have out there enforcing. I can definitely tell you it's between 10 and 20 individuals, and I'll be able to provide that information a little bit later. But we have a number of inspectors that we have in terms of my operations, so I can increase the numbers accordingly. I've got over 40 some inspectors just in one department. In another department, I've got 20 inspectors. So currently right now, though, I would say it's somewhere between 10 and 20, but I don't know the exact numbers. And we have we have what we call law enforcement individuals that are affiliated with our inspectors also as part of this enforcement of our operations. And then I think there was a second part question. What was the, can you repeat the other part of your question?
Yes, the immediate $1,000 fines, do those apply to individuals violating the mask order?
Yes, so we can fine an individual up to $1,000, yes.
Eric has a follow-up question from WIBC.
Hi, Dr. Caine. I wanted to go back to what you mentioned sort of in passing about revoking licenses. In Fishers and in Tippecanoe New County, they've sort of made that their first line. If we go beyond warnings, we look at licenses rather than fines. Why is a fine a more effective way of getting people's attention?
Well, we are always have some concern for the employees that work with some of these businesses. So we're hoping that we can get their attention first by doing the fines. And then after that, our next step is to we'll close businesses. But we're always conscious of, from an economy standpoint, if we can, we want to keep folks who may need their jobs from an economy standpoint, very importantly, but it may be that management makes decisions that may be unwise. So that's why we go to the fine first, and then we would go to closing businesses later.
Emily from Chalk Beat.
Hi, my question is for Mayor Hogsett. Will you pressure the legislature to fully fund schools starting virtually due to safety concerns?
Well, Emily, far be it from me to tell the Indiana General Assembly or the state administration what to do. I am I'm aware of the position that the President Pro Tem of the Senate has taken. But I'm also aware generally that Governor Holcomb remains committed to helping education in every possible way during the course of this pandemic. How they choose to resolve this difference between the way virtual schools are treated under Indiana law as it currently exists over and against how they decide prospectively to treat those schools who have made a decision like IPS to go virtually, at least at the beginning of the school year. I'm sure that will be resolved because all of us are committed to providing safe, quality educational opportunities for all students. So that would be my recommendation. Whether I actually engage in any kind of conversation, I'm certainly willing to, but I trust that the leadership of the Indiana General Assembly and the governor will be able to work that out so that no school is penalized simply because they are following public health recommendations during the course of this pandemic.
Kyle from the Indy Star.
Yes, Dr. Caine. High school football teams all over the state are expected to start playing next Friday night, including Marion County. At this point, are you comfortable giving the green light for that to happen? And also, what criteria will you be looking at if that is to change in the next 10 days?
So yes, we're very comfortable with giving the green light for football to start in Marion County. And the criteria that we are looking at to monitor the situation from all the schools that have sports is that we look for weekly reporting of any athlete or coach or staffing related to sports. Report to us any athlete or coach that has a positive test. We also monitor the absenteeism rate from that group who may be sick and unavailable. And based on those numbers, in totality, from a community-wide spread, we make assessments to see whether our environment stays safe. We also will continue to monitor the positivity rate in regard to our community as well.
And it looks like our last question is from Richard Essex at Wish TV.
Dr. Caine, can you elaborate on finding individuals for not wearing their mask, and has the department fined people, individuals, for not wearing their mask?
So we have fined mostly people not wearing their masks in an establishment have been the majority of our have been the current number of people that we have fined. Now, a lot of times people will send us a complaint and say, hey, I saw this individual not wearing their mask. So unless we can identify who that person is, you know, a lot of times once the complaint comes in about an individual, that person's no longer there. Sometimes photographs are sent to us, but there's no way for us to necessarily always identify who that individual is. But we'll try to make the attempt. If any of our inspectors are seeing anyone out there as they're doing their surveillance in our community, in terms of trying to provide them a fine. So, Paul, I don't know if you might want to add something in addition to that.
Yeah, I just want to say to Richard's question, you know, focusing on institutions like businesses and places and getting them to participate by enforcing the mask ordinance allows us to have, in a sense, a force multiplier of people enforcing the mask ordinance. And so really by looking at institutions to enforce the ordinance, it's going back to what the mayor and Dr. Caine said earlier about this is a community-wide endeavor to prevent the spread of COVID-19. And by getting institutions to recognize that, we're multiplying the number, in a sense, inspectors we have, and really trying to help our community help itself.
Great. Thank you so much for joining us. The copy of Dr. Caine's presentation, as well as a press release, will be going out here in a few minutes. Thanks so much.